my dad used to be cool. I mean, he's still cool to me, but...
Oh, my dad's still not cool. no, I mean, I got my love of literature and of classic movies and TV from my dad.
Mm-hmm.
But also kind of almost like I would stumble on things myself and then he would go, oh yeah, that's a thing.
Yeah.
Like Andy Griffith or I Love Lucy, those were just shows that were on.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't so much that he sat me down and showed them to me. It was that he would find me watching them and he would connect with me that way.
Yeah. My dad, he wasn't necessarily like forcing it upon us, but it was more like, you know, I want to spend time with my kids. This is what we're going to watch, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't necessarily think it was inappropriate either, you know. But he also, that's how he kind of grafted me and my brother's sense of humor. So me and my brother have more of a dry and sarcastic sense of humor because of it, though.
Mm.
You know, so we are very much the sarcastic and funny siblings. Whereas my two younger sisters, I would say they do have good sense of humor, but I would say that me and my brother probably have the more outlandish sense of humor, willing to take more risks than they are.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that solely has to do with Monty Python.
As you've gotten older, is Monty Python as dear to you as it was?
I would say that it is, in some retrospect. As I've gotten older, I think I can appreciate more of the jokes.
Mm-hmm.
Just because, like, in The Meaning of Life, I was laughing hysterically at the scene where the lady's trying to give birth to a baby. And they're making fun of, like, all the medical equipment and how expensive it is.
Yes?
What do I do?
Nothing, dear. You're not qualified.
Leave it to us.
What's that for?
That's the machine that goes bing.
You know, and they literally just don't do anything.
Yeah. And see, for me, not having been introduced to it by my father, not having grown up with it, I came into it like I was house sitting for a friend when I was 19. She had a copy of Holy Grail.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, oh, I've heard of this thing. And I watched it, and I laughed hysterically mm-hmm. at it.
It's only a model. Shh.
And eventually found Life of Brian, which is one of my favorite movies of all time.
I love Life of Brian.
And with the show, there was a lot of the stuff that I watched specifically for the first time for this.
Mm-hmm.
And I felt like all of these contrasting feelings, because some of it's great, a lot of it's not.
Well, what's funny about that is that Family Guy actually makes a joke.
Yeah, you wouldn't believe what he did to Meg yesterday. He made her watch the other 178 hours of Monty Python stuff that isn't funny or memorable.
Meg chimes in and is like,
I'm a girl! I don't even like the good Monty Python sketches!
I'm just in there and I'm like, I understand the good bits. I like the good bits. Just ignore the bad bits.
Mm-hmm. Well, and even the good bits, there's a little bit of familiarity breeds contempt.
Yeah.
Like, I've gotten to the point where it's like, I'm not as likely to laugh at them because I know them so well.
Right.
And then they'll do something stupid like, one of the things that I laughed at the hardest was slapping with fish. And it's such a little, like, 30-second bit.
Yeah.
And it's so stupid, and the punchline is so good. That it makes me continue to giggle. Ministry of Silly Walks.
Yep.
Makes me laugh. But the parrot sketch at this
the
point.
The parrot sketch. I have a love-hate relationship with the parrot sketch. The thing that makes it great is John Cleese.
Mm-hmm.
Strictly because of the fact that he takes the parrot and goes,
hello, Polly! Polly! Polly Parrot, wake up!
gets me. Mm-hmm. The rest of it, I could do without.
It's like, I thought it was really funny the first time I saw it, but then everybody fucking quotes it, which runs it into the ground, mm-hmm. which by the time you watch it again, you're like, yeah.
See, like, I do like the parrot sketch. I like the spam sketch.
Well, there's egg and bacon, egg, sausage and bacon, egg and spam, egg, bacon and spam, egg, bacon, sausage and spam, spam, bacon, sausage and spam, spam, egg, spam, spam, bacon and spam, 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 egg and spam, 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 baked beans, spam, spam, spam and spam. Oh, lobster thermidor and crevettes with mayonnaise sauce, garnished with truffle pate brandy and a fried egg on top and spam.
I can do without the Minister of Silly Walk sketch. See, like, the sketches, I feel like they're hit or miss. Mm-hmm. I feel like where they really went into having good content or was in their movies. Mm-hmm. But that was when they actually had somewhat of a storyline. So, like, Holy Grail and Life of Brian. And I hate to say that because that makes it two movies.
That is exactly how I feel, actually, is that when there's a... Because the through line, especially Holy Grail, is not... Life of Brian has much more of a story.
Yeah.
Holy Grail, it's like it's a series of sketches, but they're just Arthurian sketches.
No, on second thoughts, let's not go to Camelot. It is a silly place.
Right. Both very funny movies. Mm-hmm. With great bits, with bits where you're like, and sometimes just, I mean, I watched Life of Brian with Heather. Mm-hmm. To prepare for this. And we're laughing and stuff. And then the part where he, like, falls off the roof and into a spaceship.
Yep.
And there's just this little detour that goes absolutely nowhere. And at the end of it, she's like, what the hell was that?
that's just Monty Python. That's just Monty Python.
But which we should mention the six members.
Yep.
John Cleese, Eric Idle, Graham Chapman. The Terrys, Gilliam and Jones, and the great Michael Palin.
Yep. I love Michael Palin. He's probably the most attractive member. Sorry. He just is. Mm-hmm.
I can see it.
He's the prettiest member.
I know. Terry Gilliam, I was watching a documentary about Monty Python. Terry Gilliam was a pretty, pretty man in his day.
In his day. In his day, he was. Mm-hmm. But Michael Palin's the...
Michael Palin's the one when you grow old you want to look like.
Yes.
Him.
Yes.
Which one is your favorite as far as the members go?
I have a hard time with this one because I think they're all very talented retrospectively. Mm. I've always had a bias towards Eric Idle just because I think he's, you know, talented. And I think as a young girl, I remember distinctively remembering his voice, mm-hmm. just hearing him in, like, cartoons. Mm-hmm. Like, because he was in Quest for Camelot, and he played one of the heads of the Two-Headed Dragon.
That is a movie I have not thought about in a very long time.
And he was just very funny in it, and I remember it, and I really loved him in that. Mm-hmm. And so you know, I've always been a little biased towards him because of that. So I would have to say it's a toss-up between Eric Idle, John Cleese, and probably Michael Palin. Mm.
And this would be a tough one for me, too, because it depends on if we're just talking about Monty Python or we're talking about outside of Monty Python. Because if we're talking about outside of Monty Python, my favorite is Terry Gilliam.
Yeah.
Because he went on to be a director, and he's directed some amazing movies. Like,
he's amazing.
Yeah. I mean, I remember being probably too young to go see 12 Monkeys and having my little mind blown by it. Mm-hmm. And I identify with his twisted, weird way of looking at things.
Well, and that's the other thing too, is that I never realized that he was the one behind the artwork, mm-hmm. until I watched the documentary. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was amazing because, you know, I You know, I do artwork too, and some of the things that I will draw or do is odd and weird too. I don't ever post it because it's odd and weird, and I don't really necessarily want people to see it. And no, it's not furries. Flashback.
Comment below if you would like to see her artwork in the next episode.
Comment below if you think James is crazy.